Jesus, we come to you as we celebrate this Palm Sunday at a very trying moment in the history of the church and in the history of many of us who have never experienced something like this in our lives. But Father, we come to you with hope of Christ, who is able and above all that we are going through. And therefore, mighty God, this morning, as I stand here to bring you a message to Christians of St. Alban, wherever they are watching us, and many other Christians across the world who are tuned in our Facebook live message, we pray that, Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be accepted to you, O Lord. For this we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen.
It is a blessing for us to be in the house of the Lord. Happy Palm Sunday.
Happy Palm Sunday.
We celebrate, this is the day that our King is showcasing his kingdom and his triumphal entry to Jerusalem in a very special way, special than any other triumphal entry of earthly king. Therefore, we celebrate Christ, we celebrate this day as we meditate and go through the Palm Sunday in this difficult moment where we cannot celebrate with our Christians together. Our tradition here has been always Palm Sunday. We have been walking around as we sing Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. But today, we are not able. The situation is difficult, and I want us to take this moment to encourage our Christians wherever they are, that let us take this situation seriously, and let us ensure that whenever we get out of our houses, we put on masks and we maintain distance, even when we are doing our businesses, and we make sure that our hands are clean always. This is for our personal gain. It is my prayer that none of my Christians will die because of this pandemic. And therefore, I encourage you, my brothers and sisters, wherever you are, that take heed of the directions that are given to us by the Ministry of Health to ensure that we live to see each other after this terrifying moment of the COVID-19. Amen. I'm standing here to bring the message of the Lord from the first reading of Zechariah. Zechariah chapter 9 from verse 9. And my topic this morning is the coming King and his deliverance. The coming King and his deliverance. Verse 9 specifically highlights that the coming king is a lowly, is a humble king as he comes into Jerusalem. He shows that indeed he is a lowly king, he is a different king from other kings that we have been used to. He's a different king as he comes to us. Behold, your king is coming. Behold, your king is coming to you. Lowly and riding on a donkey. Lowly and humble. Riding on a donkey. Riding on a donkey. Traditionally, no king entered into his triumphal entry to any city on a donkey. They came on the male horses, which are very powerful, like today's limousines we see in our presidentials, whenever they enter into a city with motorcades, everything comes to a standstill. But this king comes riding not only just a donkey, but a colt. A colt. Not a normal donkey, but a colt. A colt is a small virgin donkey. Actually, it is a blameless donkey. The donkey itself symbolizes the king who is coming. That this king is blameless too, has no sin, and the colt that he is coming riding is also a blameless with no sin. He's coming different from the traditional kings when they enter into a triumphant stallion, like earthly generals. His coming is contrary to the Alexander the Great when he entered into Jerusalem. Brethren, let us be lowly, let us be humble, and then we shall act in humility just like our Lord. It is good to be humble as Christians, because the one that we follow was humble. Brothers and sisters, we should not condemn pride, and yet we feel as proud as Lucifer himself. Many times we tend to condemn pride, and yet we ourselves, we are living a life of pride. However, we must pray God to make us humble. And I want to say that being humble does not mean that, many people relate humble to poverty. Humble or humility is not the sign of poverty. It is the sign that even though you are wealth, by the wealth you have, it is by the grace of God that you have them. And therefore, as we remain humble, it doesn't ensure that we are poor. We are humble and we are rich because the wealth we have, it is from God. And therefore, nothing we have that can make us to be proud. It's only thieves. The corruptions are humble because the wealth they have stolen from our taxations. But Christians, whatever we have is from God. And therefore, we need to remain humble because our Lord is humble himself. Praise God.
Amen.
A donkey or a colt, the foal, as I have said earlier. This emphasis is that the animal is pure bred, is blameless. And the one that is coming in the entering into Jerusalem is blameless. Even though the kings and the structure and the culture of the time tried to blackmail him, that did not deter him, neither did not cause him to become sin. he remained blameless and pure bread. Even us today, we can remain pure regardless of the society we are in. The society that is pushing us, that if you are not corrupt, you are not normal. Actually, somebody said that we should legalize corruption to be part and parcel of the ethos of Kenyans. Because it seems like every Kenyan is corrupt, but I want to challenge that person that not all of us are not corrupt. We are faithful stewards of God, and we must remain pure as God himself is pure. God had commanded the kings of Israel not to multiply horses. The kings who broke this command were miserable. He commanded them not to multiply horses, because the earthly kings, they multiply horses. Just imagining when a king or a president leaves his state house or whatever and goes somewhere, the motorcades that follows them, and all of them are gasslers. Every kilometer they are taking the taxations from poor people. And therefore God is reminding the earthly kings, earthly priests and bishops, earthly Christians, that we should not multiply our horses, but we should come in humble, and we should come in peace. Because when Jesus entered into Jerusalem, he entered and in humble, and he was coming in peace. Bwana Yesu asifiwe.
Amen.
That is why Jesus came to fulfill the law. And we can see how he came to Jerusalem, showed humility. He entered Jerusalem in different. Actually, people who were watching him, they were having mixed reactions. Their minds were confused as they were celebrating and calling, shouting, "Hosanna, Hosanna." Their mind was still mixed up. They are wondering, they have never seen a king come like this man. King, all kings come in stallion with horses, with motorcades. But this guy is coming in on a colt, even he is abusing, coming on a small colt, a small donkey, he's abusing. People were shouting Hosanna, but the reaction of their mind were mixed up. They are wondering, is he truly a king or he's pretending? Because he never came like an earthly king. Beloved, as Christians, we can live in this earth and be rich, but remain as humble and remain as peaceful as Christ remained. Because wealth should not define us. Remember, Christ is the owner of everything. Gold and silver belongs to him. He owns 1,000 cattle on a hill, but he remained humble. Wealth did not define him. When Lucifer was given opportunity to lead worship, he became so proud. But God, who created heaven and earth, remained humble. Even us today, as we celebrate this Palm Sunday, we can remain humble, regardless of what God has blessed us with. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Rejoice greatly. Shout for joy. Behold, your king is coming. Zechariah's prophecy is known as the triumphal entry of Jesus Christ. In Matthew chapter 21, verse 5, when he presented himself as the Messiah to Jerusalem and the people of Israel, this is a prophecy that Isaiah is raising several thousand hundreds of years before Jesus was born. But God showed him this prophecy, what will happen. And therefore, he's saying what is going to happen, what already happened now in the New Testament as we celebrate him today. Though the triumphal entry was a joyful celebration, but to Romans would wonder what was so triumphant about this entry. Because the Romans would come into real horses. As they enter, you would see the horses. They were looking at this guy as he was entering into Jerusalem, and they were wondering, what is this? What is about this? What is good about this man? He's coming in poor, in resembling poverty, total poverty. He never had a motorcade, apart from the poor people who are following him, shouting him Hosanna. They were wondering to the Romans. Jesus' triumphal entry was nowhere comparison to the king of parade or triumphal of Julius Caesar when he comes back, when he came back to Rome from Gaul. I hear that his triumphal entry lasted for 3 days. You can imagine. 3 days when the motorcade is following him, or when the horses are following him, for 3 days, the guy entering into a city, for 3 days, a motorcade. Even a presidential motorcade does not last for that. But 3 days. So when they were looking at Jesus, they were laughing at him. This is a poor king, cannot even fight us. Because they were thinking that he will come with guns, with everything, but he came with the word of God. And in his name, it is more powerful than the Roman Empire with their own machineries to fight. He had a parade that lasts for 3 days as he displayed all the captives and the boot he brought back from fight, from war. So, our Lord, his parade did not last even a single day. Jesus' parade showed that he was pretty humble, and this showed that Jesus was a different king of a kind. Therefore, the difference between the two is the mission. The difference between Julius Caesar and Jesus Christ of Nazareth is the mission. Caesar's mission was to humiliate, is to render, to make poor people, is to destroy the nation and war. But Jesus' entry was to save life. His mission was to show that I came not with guns, but I came with the word of hope. That whoever believes in me shall be born again. And whoever believes in me will enter into the kingdom of God. His humility, his mission was different. Verse 10. The strength and the authority of the Messiah's reign. Verse 10 says this. The Lord says, I will remove the war chariots from Israel and take the horses from Jerusalem. The bows used in battle will be destroyed. Your king will make peace among the nations. He will rule from sea to sea, from the river Euphrates to the ends of the earth. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
You can see his mission is totally different. The other king's mission is, how can we multiply the weapons? How can we get the best weapons? Today, America and China and Russia are competing to make the best weapons. They are fighting for the nuclear. That even North Korea have become dangerous even to the entire world. Because whatever he has, no one knows. But Jesus comes to tell them that you are going to destroy everything that you have. Praise the Lord. He's coming to destroy everything that they have. Because he's coming to restore the world back to the honor. How it was in the beginning. Where we would commune with God, where we would live in harmony with one another, where we will see each other as a brother and sister, not where we will see a lady, a young baby, and you molest her, not where you will see a young boy and you molest her, Not where you will cut your parents with axe so that you can all get their wealth. Not where you will burn your wife and the children in the house. He's coming to restore the sanctity of life back. Beloved, we need to hearken to the word of God. Because when he come to restore the vices of this earth, to restore back, that I can see my brother. I politicians can see each other and not divide us on tribal lines. Because he's coming to restore the world back to its honor. And whoever believes and belongs to Jesus indeed is restored back.
Amen.
His dominion shall be from sea to sea. When Jesus rules over this earth, his reign will be universal. The entire earth shall be under his authority. Is indeed under his authority. It is not fully, but that is his mission. His mission is different from what the children of Israel expected, that he will come and fight the enemy. His coming is to restore everyone back to God. Therefore, we ought to hearken to his call, so that we may see God again, as the Adam and Eve saw him. Judah's liberation and blessings in verse 11. The Lord says, because of my covenant with you, that was sealed by the blood of sacrifices, I will set your people free, free from the waterless pit of exile. Here, I want to remind you that Zechariah is prophesying at a dangerous time. Zechariah was a grandchild of a prophet who was there before. And Zechariah was born in the exile where the children of Israel were for 70 years in exile. And now he's coming up as a child prophesying what God is going to do to these children of Israel. The Lord God will bow the trumpet. The idea is that the Lord himself will lead the battle to lead the children of Israel from the exile under the Babylonian Empire and return them back. But remember Jeremiah 29:11 tells them that they should not be in a hurry. Because God is not going to remove them from exile very fast. And God tells them, you can go ahead and marry, look for good, beautiful girls, marry there, get lands, plow, plant everything, make things, enjoy your life, because I am not in a hurry to do what? To remove you from exile. 70 years is not a simple, it's not small years, friends. It's not small years. To be in exile for 70 years and you start lamenting of going back, forget about that. You now get their ladies, marry them, and begin your life. But there is hope, promise that I will still restore you. Bwana Yesu asifiwe. God makes it clear who does the fighting is God. The Lord their God will save them in that day. Therefore, regardless of God's promises in Jeremiah that you can go ahead and do what, enjoy your life, he himself is the one who will restore them back. Friends, what is it that is troubling you today? What is it that is making you feel like you want to commit suicide? What is it that is causing you today that you are thinking of how to kill your spouse? How to destroy your parents? What is it God is promising you that with the challenges you are going through, forget about them, concentrate on God, and focus on your life. Enjoy your life. At the appropriate time, the Lord will restore you back. And you will have peace. And you will come back to where you wanted to be by the grace of God. This is God's battle, not the battle of men. Therefore, let us focus and put our hope only in Christ Jesus. He promises blessings for all you who have suffered. I will pay you twice. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
This is the climax as I finish this sermon. That God himself himself promises us blessings. It is not man. A man's promises are as lie, as useless as he says them. A man will tell you, when you finish college, I will give you a job. But the day you will finish college, whenever you will reach out to him, he will never pick you a collar. But God promises you, and God's promises are yes and amen. When he tells you, count it as already a banked check. That is already done. When he tells you that his promises is to bless you, he is going to bless you. No matter what you go through, he's going to bless you. No matter COVID, he's going to bless you. I say that this year, no matter how difficult COVID it will be, his promises on us are yes and amen, and are already done. We are going to fulfill them. No matter what we go through, let us remain faithful to God. Let us remain tandem to God, because he is faithful and he is going to fulfill his blessings. Amen.
Amen.
Therefore, whatever suffering we go through, he's going to pay us twice. As I pray, I want to encourage you, brothers and sisters, let us remain faithful to God. He is faithful. He is able. He is Alpha and Omega. He is the great I am. Today he is entering into Jerusalem. Tomorrow they will be saying, crucify him, crucify him. But we shall remain with God. Whether we walk through the nails, whether we walk through the fire, whether we walk through the scorching sun, let us remain on the side of Christ, because his promises are yes and amen, and he will never let us down. I want to encourage you that tomorrow we continue with our services. Tomorrow we will be projecting our services again in the evening. Until Good Friday, our services will be on. And Christians, please remain, come and remain following us online as we reach out to you by the grace of God. Let us pray. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you and bless you for this word that changes not, for your promises that are yes and amen. That regardless of the challenges we are going through, whatever you promised us will come to pass. Whether the enemy rises 1,000 times, you will only take those you promised, you know that they will die today, this year. But those who will live, and their promises will be fulfilled. Therefore, mighty God, we thank you as we celebrate this day. In the name of God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God bless you.